Hi, it's Larry Herb, Xbox's Major Nelson. Welcome to the official Xbox podcast. I'm going to get ready to bring my lovely co-hosts in here. Now this...
Lights out.
Why did you miss the lights? What happened? I don't know. There they are. We're going to get that in. I don't care. Anyway, it's good to see you guys. As I was telling you before we got started, Jeff and I and Rebecca were talking off the air. We need to get some things out of the way right at the top of the podcast. This is the official Xbox podcast. This is the only place you get members of the Xbox team. Me and Jeff and Rebecca and liking and subscribing and all that stuff. Jeff, do you want to kind of do some of this? I'm doing it terribly.
Larry, this is where you say that... We release every Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific time, or you could say West Coast, Best Coast time, but that would really be stealing from Snowbike Mike.
And I don't believe West Coast is Best Coast. East Coast is Beast Coast.
Yeah,
you can have that. Also, sure.
Thank you.
Yeah. But it doesn't mean
you can have the Beast Coast.
Yes.
Anyway.
Sure. Rhyming aside, what I would say is, yes, we're available on YouTube. We're available on podcast resources, systems, distribution channels from all over the globe. So please leave your comments. We love we've really been enjoying engaging with you over these past couple of months in the YouTube comments. I swear this is the only YouTube channel where you do read the comments, and they're great. So thanks for your
and we reply. Rebecca, if you want to go in and reply, I know you may not want to. That's probably the last thing you want
no,
to.
It's okay. I don't mind replying to some of them, but y'all, please stop addressing comments to my mom. But aside from that, I'm happy to.
Oh yes. Anyway, but thank you for that, Jeff. So yeah, as Jeff said, we release each week, or as often as we'd like. Got a lot of stuff going on, and again, this is the only podcast where you can hear people directly on the Xbox team talk to you. And we bring in folks from the Xbox team. This week, we've got some great interviews about some new features that are now available on Xbox Series X. Plus, we're going to talk about Windows 11. That is coming out, depending upon when you're listening to this. It's coming out either it's out now or it's coming out in the next week. So we've got a lot going on in this show, but usually we talk about what we're playing. Rebecca, I'm going to start with you. What are you playing?
Okay, cool. Well, so I really wanted to participate in the Halo Infinite multiplayer tech preview this last weekend, but I had a friend in town and there were only some like really specific windows that didn't really jive with my East Coast schedule, unfortunately. Right, right. But Big Team Battle is on this weekend, so I would highly recommend folks check it out. I'm going to check it out finally. But aside from that, I got a chance to play Sable, which released last week. You might remember I got a chance to speak with Greg from Shedworks about the game, and it is pretty cool. I think that a lot of the footage in the trailers that you saw were really indicative of the like experience. Like, it is very whimsical. Like, the art style is amazing. It's also kind of refreshing to just like walk at a wall and just start climbing it immediately. Like, you can climb on everything in that game, which is kind of fun. But yeah, it's pretty cool. And then you can definitely also see like the Star Wars influences in it too, just with the lonely desert.
You did a couple weeks ago where you felt like there was a little bit of it, which is great. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it, but it was great to see that it carried through for you.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. I would highly recommend folks give it a chance. It's on Game Pass.
What do you think about the soundtrack? Because Japanese Breakfast had something to do with that, and they're having a hell of a year.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty cool. I'm not gonna lie. I usually like it depends on the game, but I kind of listen to music like on the side while I'm playing games. So maybe I should listen to the soundtrack on this one. I'm sure it would add to it. But yeah,
I loved it.
I
started playing Sable as well. So I'm only in the first area, like on the first series of quests. But I'm having a good time with it. To your point, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's cool. And then aside from that, I've been spending some more time in Psychonauts. I'm determined to defeat it sometime soon. Not defeat, but yeah. I've heard such good things.
Let us know when you get to the psychedelic level.
And the psychedelic part. Yeah, I know. Awesome. Yeah. What have you guys been playing?
Well, I'll jump in. I mean, I've been playing Golf Peaks. Have you played Golf Peaks yet? Actually, it's not on Game Pass. This is a golfing game. It's been out on mobile for a few years, but it's a golfing game in like name and look only. It's not like you're not swinging and hit the ball particularly. You've got like cards, Jeff and Rebecca. And it's an isometric view. If you go look up it online, it's an isometric view of like you're teeing off here and here's the hole. You can go, you've got a series of cards that you have to play in a certain area and in a certain direction to get the ball from point A into the hole. So it's like, with this card, you're going to hit it twice. So it goes, you know, over two blocks. And then this card is going to go up one block. And so it's a puzzle game and it's a lot of fun. I've been playing that.
Speaking of that, Larry. Yes. So there's like a lot of like, it has the word golf in the name, but it's not actually golf. And there was another one that came out really recently. I've heard some really, really good buzz on called Golf Club Wasteland. And basically it's like humanity has moved to moon or Mars or something like that.
It's moved on.
But then they come back to Earth and they just treat the whole planet, which has been like, obviously like crumbling as a golf course and just hit balls. I don't know if that's maybe from that scene in I Am Legend. Remember, he's like hitting golf balls through Times Square.
He's hitting the golf balls right near where you currently live, if I remember correctly, Rebecca.
Yeah, off of that ship, right?
Off of the carrier. Yeah, it's off of, I believe it's off.
Yeah,
the
yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's hitting it off of the wing of a plane on the carrier, if I remember correctly.
Anyway, so
that's what happens after the
they made a video game about it. It's called Golf Club Wasteland. It's $9.99, available on Xbox One and Series X and S. So, and I've heard just very good things about it. It's on my list to try out.
I'll have to check that.
Another
one I'm playing is, for some strange reason, I'm playing this like story game called Teacup. Have you seen this one?
No.
Nope.
It's like a very childlike with children's artwork. And all I know is I opened a door and I got 100 gamer score. So I was happy. So playing that, Sea of Thieves. I'm very excited to report that I have finished the Pirate's Life, all of the quests in the Pirate's Life. And I finished all of the commendations, which means I have unlocked the Yo-Ho of Pirate's Life for me, Shanty. So I'm very, I know it doesn't mean a lot to you guys, but it's if you do everything, that's the only way you can get this shanty, and I unlocked it. So I was very happy about that.
Nice work.
Do you have like the Black Pearl or something? Do you get that as well?
You can buy a livery like that for your ship. But anyway, so that's one thing. So I finished that, and then of course we talked about the Halo Infinite beta that Jeff and I, and Rebecca, you said you weren't around to play it, but Jeff and I played quite a bit this weekend, and we had some good matches.
We had quite the run. I think when I came in with you and you'd been playing for a little bit, we ran, I want to say, five matches. We won four of them, yep. A couple of them just like, you know, it's interesting, I think, because it's just getting started. There's sometimes you run into a group and you're like, oh, these people know what they're doing. I think someone had a great tweet. It was like, if you run into this group and it was people with like a bunch of X's in their name, like, you're going to lose badly.
Right.
but we're playing as a team, good communication. This is my pro tip, and you can do whatever you want, but as someone who plays a lot of Apex, I like to tag things using the right bumper. And you can basically just reallocate or remap any of the controls. And so by default, it's up on the D-pad, and right bumper is tools, like grappling hook or things like that. And I swap those two. So I'm more frequently tagging. I think it's better for the team. I still have to figure out if there's a better place for me to put those tools. The repulsor is really cool. I've seen some great videos on social, people knocking people off of cliffs and stuff like that. So work in progress, but use your tagging. It helps everybody. Your player will shout out what they're seeing. And so if you need to remap it to make it more accommodating or so that you'll use it more, it makes you a good teammate.
And I will say this, my tip is, and I don't know if Jeff, did you and I play Sunday night when it was, I think, I don't know if we did, but
that was when we played.
Yeah. One of the tips that, one of the guys from 343 told me was you can go into the settings, Rebecca, and you can, you know, basically it's, I think it's under visuals, but scroll down and it's basically you're going to see, when you see enemies, are they outlined in red? And your team default, your friendlies are outlined in blue. I find if you go in, and I believe the color they use in the user interface is mint. You change your team to mint, and you can you can see your teammates just pop. It just pops more, at least for my eyes.
Interesting.
That's cool. Yeah, so that's what it is. But yeah, you said you're going to be around this weekend, and actually, everybody, if you go check out Xbox Insiders, they posted that it's open to every that the Halo Infinite beta for Big Team Battle will be open to everybody, but you got to kind of go through and sign up. So go check those guys out and go check that Twitter handle out. Jeff, what are you playing? You've been I see something. Actually, you need to reconnect your controller over your right shoulder.
No,
flashing at me.
So. Well, first, you were talking about Windows 11 earlier, and yeah. I was giving my Windows 11 rig a workout by playing Deathloop, which I finished this weekend, and yes. It is an incredible game.
You didn't tell me that. I know you were into it. I didn't realize that you finished
saving it for this. Oh, I got very into it. I didn't want to play anything else, and so I just really mained that for like the better part of a week. I should look and see how many hours I put into it, but it just got completely into it. It is.
I'm gonna go look right now.
I think we talked a little bit about this last week. You really should watch some videos if you think, oh, I don't like roguelikes, or I don't like, I don't know, time games or things like that. It's really not like that. And you spend the majority of the game, they make it pretty clear in all the trailers, like the way you break the loop of death is you got to kill all the bosses in one day. Right. And it sort of gave me like thoughts of like going back to like the original Dead Rising or something like that, right, where it could be really stressful, and it doesn't work out like that. The time sort of freezes when you're in a level and you can sort of take all your time, and you're spending most of the game essentially trying to figure out how to do it. And then you do it, and that's where it's really cool. And I didn't get nervous in the game until that point. And I was like, I've come too far. And I ended up on that final state, that final step. I was using my teleport, my blink, shift, I think it's called, ability. Watch, and I mistimed it. And these are not spoilers. These are all stuff in trailers and things like that. Anyway, I mistimed a jump and I landed in I'm playing very stealthy, and I landed right in a crowd of a bunch of people, and it turned into a huge gunfight, which I swiftly lost.
Did it turn into a rabble? Did it, Jeffrey?
it was not good, and I ended up having to redo the day, and then I beat the game. But yeah, it was just, it's just an excellent game. Incredibly intelligent, phenomenal voice acting. And so highly recommend you give that a shot. Played that on Windows 11 on my widescreen PC, and super fun. It's gonna be a lot of end of year lists for sure.
And then
besides that, yeah,
that's what you're playing.
Lost Judgment, which I just realized it has this thing where if you move the stick, it changes the camera for some reason on the title screen, and I could just do that all day. Sweet. Anyway, we've talked about Lost Judgment. You've given me some stick for talking too much about games by the Yakuza team, but I will just say I got something in the mail this weekend, and it was this thing.
I got one of those too.
Zoom out. What is it? Go full screen.
Oh, sure, absolutely. You want to see it?
Escape Four. Oh. So Yagami has a skateboard that he uses to go around Yokohama, because it's big and it's faster to skateboard, and they sent me this. So thanks to them, hashtag not really an ad, they just did give it to me. Not sponsored, but I love the games. And it's really fun. So I'm pretty early into that, and that's available now. And Larry is not available now. He's gone. What? What?
Getting his skateboard too?
What's he got here? He's got cables. He's all over the place. This is an unscripted field trip. There he is.
Well, my favorite part, Jeff, is actually, did you get a chance? We haven't even talked about this. Have you gotten a chance to play with this thing?
No, they sent the drone. I haven't tried it yet because it's been rainy. But how was it?
It's so Rebecca, they sent this drone over, and I actually start. I have no idea if this is going to work.
Oh, no.
Oh, this is not going to be good.
At least it's a good idea.
Anyway, do it. I guess it's not going to work. That's
fine. No, don't.
Anyway,
I would like to request for next week's episode, you put these things to use and go skateboarding together in the neighborhood.
this is not a good sign when they're blinking like that. But yeah, so we got this drone in here. What I did find out, Jeff, is, let me shut this off so it's not blinding folks. Is the cameras mounted upside down? So when you hook it to your phone, the image is upside down. So I haven't had a chance to play with this outside. I was flying it around the house because my family wasn't around, so I was able to fly it around.
Yeah. Well, in the game, Yagami is a
controls
detective.
Are inverted?
I didn't even get that far. The only thing I was able to do with it, because I was so afraid of like taking out the chandelier, was I did, you know, up and down. I have no idea. That was kind of it. And when I say up, I turned it on. And when I went down, I turned it off. So I really wasn't controlling it properly.
So. Interesting. Well, in the game, he's a detective, and I haven't gotten that far into this one, but I'm sure the drone is in it, and you use it to sort of like stake places out from a safe distance. Like he'll be on a rooftop across the street or something like that. Uses the camera drone. Oh, the bad guy is in this room. Let's head him off here. And so there you go. Now you too can be a private detective, Larry, if things don't work out here in the podcasting world.
I can be a private detective / drone pilot. So anyway, it's amazing how these things just kind of, they can fit in your pocket in some regards. Oh, the technology.
If you're wearing cargo pants, I told you not to wear those. It's not the best look.
No, I don't wear cargo pants. Anyway. All right. Moving right along. What else you got, Jeff? I mean, you've been busy this week playing those games
That's it. Plenty more to play. So just going to keep going.
Looking forward to next week and beyond when Far Cry is out. I know Jeff and I are going to be doing that. We have done, I think this will be our third one that we do together with
four, five and six. Yeah.
Yeah. So that'll be a lot of fun. But, oh boy, we've got, you know, you talked about Windows 11, Jeff. We've talked about a lot going on. We've got a bunch of interviews this week, one of which is with Panos Panay, who's the head of the Windows team and Surface. You've probably seen him. He's an amazing individual. So I had a chance to chat with him. And then, did you see the news about Dolby Vision this week, gang?
Yeah? No, yes. I mean, we did. I didn't know. Are you teaming this up?
I know, I'm like, we can talk about it now. But yeah, so Dolby Vision Gaming is available now on Xbox Series X and S, which includes more than 100 next-gen HDR titles, either optimized for Xbox Series X and S now or coming soon. I think the Xbox Series X and S are also the first consoles to support gaming in Dolby Vision and Atmos,
Yes, we are. So, but I was able to catch up with somebody from on our team, Katie Slattery from our team. We'll talk to her first, and then Ashley Arnold from the Dolby team. So, what do you say? We roll those interviews now. We'll come back on the other side, and we'll get all the news lined up for you this week. So, stay tuned. This week, I'm really excited because Xbox has shipped the most amazing thing. This is Dolby Vision on the console for Xbox Series X and S. And joining me today is Katie Slattery. Katie, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Very, very excited to be here today.
Got to tell you, I'm really excited. You and I have been talking about this feature for quite some time. We shipped it earlier this week for Xbox Series X and X. This is Dolby Vision. Before we talk about the feature on the console, I want to talk about your journey and what you do at Xbox, and kind of, because it's interesting how this feature made it to the console vis-a-vis you. So tell us a little bit about your journey.
Yeah, absolutely. So back in 2018, we had launched Dolby Vision for media streaming, and at the time, we had partnered with Netflix and a couple of other premium media service subscriptions. And immediately, we heard feedback that says, like, this is awesome. We're really excited. When is this coming to gameplay? So we got together as a team internally and started thinking about how can we bring this to our gamers? How can we help enhance our gameplay and bring this cutting-edge technology never before seen to games to Xbox consoles?
And we're going to have somebody on. I'm going to have someone on later in the show from Dolby specific. But can you just give us kind of a top line, explain what Dolby Vision is for people that are like may have heard of it or don't know?
Yeah, absolutely. So Dolby Vision is an advanced high dynamic range technology, which enhances the visuals by bringing brighter brights and darker darks and more vivid colors to a given scene, or in this case, gameplay.
So for those of you that you may have heard, that may sound familiar because we've been talking at Xbox about HDR high dynamic range for some time. And this is really Dolby's building on that technology. Would that be right, Katie?
Yeah, that's totally correct.
And so the feature shipped earlier this week. And for those of you that don't know kind of how to get it, it's pretty straightforward. But there's a couple things you need to have to ensure that you can get this experience. Katie, could you walk us through what we need to make sure that, you know, that I'm ready to go? And more importantly, because this is what Xbox gamers, if you don't know, this is what Xbox gamers look for. They look for all the green checkboxes, and you can see mine there. So can you explain to us what we need to kind of have that Dolby Vision gaming experience?
Absolutely. So we just launched this feature on our Series X and S consoles for Dolby Vision supported TVs. There is a list available that Dolby hosts of the supported TVs, so a user can go check it. But also, feel free to go to the TV 4K details page, find under settings, make sure to update your TV firmware to make sure that you're running the latest and greatest.
Yep.
Additionally,
I'm sorry, I just want to show that little, this is what you're going to see. You can see that little box in the lower right hand corner. You got to check that. And I'm sure, assuming your TV has, as Katie said, as your firmware updated, it may flicker a little bit and then everything should be okay.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
One of the other things that I actually got tripped up on when I was putting my Series X in here is, and this is absolutely critical. Let me go back to this because it actually shows it in one of our screens. And that is, you need to make sure, right, that kind of that third line down there, you want to make sure you're using the HDMI cable that came with the console, because that is a different type of, I mean, certainly you're buying HDMI cables on Mono Price or off Amazon, and I'm sure they're fine, but to ensure that you're going to have this great experience, use the one we included in there, right, Katie?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's really interesting technology, and not only that, but we've got a lot of games that are using it right away, kind of as we shipped it. Tell us a little bit about that.
Sure. So when we first launched this feature for our general audience, we had 18 titles within a given curated list of both Dolby Vision and Atmos supported feature sets. Since then, over the last couple of days, we've been adding to the collection and now have a robust titles for all users to enjoy with that Dolby Vision support TV. For more information, please check out the store for the latest collection available.
Yeah, we also have, I've got a little bit of it right here, and this is, obviously we're pre-recording this before it airs, but you can kind of see they're updating the store page here on Xbox.com with some of the titles. So you'll be able to see some of those things, or you can check it out on your console, the store app on your console. You can kind of throw in, there's a collection is exactly that. It's a collection of the games that you can kind of enjoy with Dolby Vision, assuming that you have, there's a couple things you got to make sure. Your TV has to have the updated firmware, right, Katie?
Absolutely.
Updated firmware. You have to have the right cable that came with your Xbox Series X or S. Of course, you need an Xbox Series X or S, and then a TV that supports it. So it's not that complicated. You just kind of go through and check a few boxes to make sure that you have all the right things in your technology chain. So that's the greatest thing. I want to talk also about with the kind of the better experience. My understanding is that we need to have the ALLM. Can you talk a little bit about that and make sure what that is and how we have to have that enabled?
Yeah, so ALLM is our automatic low latency mode that some TV manufacturers help support. Dolby Vision helps combine with other cutting edge technology features, in addition to features such as ALLM, to bring the best gaming experience. So you get great visuals with Dolby Vision gaming, and then you get that low latency mode with ALLM supported, and you get great gameplay experience.
And Katie, your team, you know, you are one of the many people on your team. I know you speak for a lot of folks on the team and the engineering side that, you know, your goal is to make it as easy as possible so that, again, you can go check with all those check marks to make sure that you've got everything all set up properly. You've got the right cable, the right TV, the right firmware, and all that other stuff. So you should never really question, is this working or not? And then the other fun part is that some TVs, I know on my LG, it tells it even pops up and says Dolby Vision. So when I go into a game, it'll actually, it's kind of like, yes, I know that it works, but is it really working? Yeah, the TV says it's working, so I guess it's working and it looks great. So that's kind of another bonus there, right?
Mm-hmm. We also brought this enhancement of Dolby Vision on our platform to a wide variety of titles, even beyond the collection. So the collection highlights particular titles in partnership with Dolby and Dolby Vision, but we also brought and wanted to make sure we expanded this to a large and robust library of titles that also supported HDR and auto HDR. So with the launch of this feature, we're going to have thousands of titles. You'll see that Dolby Vision Toast pop up if your TV supports it, not just on the store collection, but also for some of your old favorites as well.
Katie, very excited to check out Dolby Vision. I know a lot of folks are getting ready to update their firmware and go through all the things we talked about. Do you have any final words before I let you go?
Yeah, this has been such a fantastic journey to be able to launch this feature. Honestly, one of my favorite parts about working at Xbox and being able to work on this feature is it's something that's never been done before. we had to work in partnership with Dolby. We worked in partnership with a lot of TV manufacturers and even studios to deliver on the cutting edge of technology for something that, you know, has never been seen on the game console before. It really excites me to be able to work on and create new tech and new experiences and new features that our gamers and our customers will enjoy. So I have personally really, really enjoyed working on this and happy to ship it.
Well, well said, Katie. On behalf of the Xbox universe out there and all the gamers, thank you very much for enhancing our experience and keep up the great work. Thank you. Well, we heard about Dolby Vision on Xbox, but I wanted to get an expert in here and talk about Dolby Vision with Dolby. So joining me today is Ashley from Dolby Labs. Ashley, it is great to see you.
Thank you. It's great to be here. Thank you for having me.
I mean, you and I have talked on and off over the years when we're working on Dolby Atmos on the console, and now we're working on Dolby Vision. I'm a big fan of Dolby and what you all do in terms of bringing this really rich experience to, you know, movies for many, many, many years through, through all your audio programs and in movies. But now you've brought your expertise into gaming. That's got to be real exciting for you guys.
Yeah, I mean, at Dolby, we're all about storytelling and bringing consumers as close to their entertainment experiences as possible. And as games have basically come up to the quality standard of Hollywood blockbusters, it made natural sense for us to take the Dolby Vision technology from movies and TVs and bring them into the gaming space. And to your point, we started doing that many, many years ago with movies and TVs. And so we're really excited about what's coming.
And this is really great because we've had Dolby Atmos, your audio technology, on Xbox Series X and S for quite some time, and I've enjoyed it a lot with my soundbar. And now you've got Dolby Vision. Tell us a little bit. I heard Katie talk about it earlier, but I'd like to. How do you guys think about Dolby Vision, and why did you say, "Hey, we should come up with this thing called Dolby Vision"? And what does it mean? Tell me a little bit about that. Give me some of the background.
Yeah. So our teams were doing research. A decade ago, maybe, about, how could we take what we see in real life as people and bring it to screens? How do we translate that? And the standards that were being used to create, TVs and movies were really outdated to the capabilities of old televisions, frankly. And so we said, okay, what could we do to improve this? And how could we make each of these pixels better and take full advantage of the screens? And that's how we came up with the idea of high dynamic range, which is Dolby Vision. And we started rolling that out to market.
Now, Katie earlier talked about how it's on the console. You can go see a collection of games in the stores. And we've gone through some of the older games and kind of automatically done some fun work with them from the engineering side in terms of making them look better. But we also talked about the fact that there's a lot involved in Dolby Vision in terms of making sure you've got the right cable, the right TV. You need an Xbox Series X or S, and they got to have a game to play. So there's a lot going on there. But when you guys think about the technology, tell us what are some of your guiding principles when you're thinking about this audio or video technology?
Yeah, so at Dolby, we really want to create ecosystems. So we work really hard to work with the content creators, with the distributors, and with the device manufacturers to ensure that we can enable an end-to-end experience for consumers. And at the end of the day, that's what we really want to do. We want to deliver the best audio and the best video for whatever device you're watching or playing on.
When we released the feature to Xbox Series X and S earlier this week, people have to go in, they got to put the check on and so on. But we actually released a little bit of a video that I have here. And this is tough to show because, I've got the audio down so you and I can talk over. But you kind of do your best here to show standard HDR on the right and Dolby Vision on the left. And there's some really stark differences when you start looking at it, aren't there?
Yeah. So, some of the key benefits of bringing Dolby Vision to games are, the brighter highlights. You're going to see a crisp sun in the sky without losing details in the clouds. You're also going to see a lot of details in the darks and in the shadows. And if that's, an enemy lurking. And all of this is to bring you, a more immersive gaming experience. Personally, one thing I'm excited about, I'm playing a game right now where there's a lot of clues. And sometimes there could be one right in front of me that I can't necessarily see. And with the added contrast of Dolby Vision, it should really help with that.
I don't know. I'm just going to do what gamers would do is like look back on your console there over your right shoulder and see what you're playing.
I got a little Ori on the go. It's probably my favorite right now.
we talked also with Katie about this is, Xbox Series X and S are the first consoles to have this technology. So that's got to be pretty exciting for you guys to bring this technology, which before was in motion pictures, some of it was on television, but now it's the next frontier for y'all. It's for games.
It's super exciting. We are thrilled. This has been a 2+ year journey working with the team at Xbox, who've been amazing partners. And we're just really excited to bring this technology to games. We've had Dolby Atmos for audio, and we really feel like this is the great complement to gaming and Dolby.
What's the best way for people to kind of, you know, whether they're just beginning their upgrade journey of like they have their Series X and S, and now they're like, well, maybe I need a new TV. Where should they go for more information on Dolby Atmos?
So luckily there's a wide range of televisions that support both Dolby Vision and Dolby Atmos. And we've worked really hard to make sure they're accessible at a wide range of prices. So different TV manufacturers will offer them different price points, and they're all going to deliver an amazing visual and audio experience. Oh. And you can always learn more at Dolby.com.
That's the best thing. I mean, it's always great to talk to you guys. I love having, you know, you or someone from Dolby Labs on the show to talk, whether it's audio because I'm an audio nerd or video because I'm a video nerd. But it's just so exciting to be not only to have this technology available in my games today, and there's going to be a lot of future games that are going to be using it, but the fact that it also works with existing and older games as well. So if I go into my library, I'm like, oh, this is now, you know, that little on my TV, the little thing pops up and it says it's Dolby Vision. I actually get excited because I'm like, oh, let me see what it looks like. So that's fun.
Yeah, I mean, we want to deliver the best experience to the most games for the most people. So we worked with Microsoft to develop tools for developers to bring Dolby Vision to their games, depending on what makes the most sense for their title. So we've got, you know, 100 titles available or coming soon in Dolby Vision. And then, as you mentioned, we've got a pipeline of titles like Halo Infinite, and we're also using some advanced visual enhancements for legacy titles, making sure that we're making everything look good across the board.
There you go. Now, like I said earlier, if you want to, and Katie said it in the previous interview, you want to go check it out, go check out the store. We've got a special collection of all the games lined up there, so you can kind of go through there. I'm sure, you know what? I bet you, even whether it's in Game Pass or whether you own the game, I bet you there's at least one game in there that you have Dolby Vision ready to go on. So it's just a great conversation to have with you, Ashley, and it's always good to see you. And any final words before I let you go?
It's been a wonderful partnership with Xbox, and just a huge thank you to everyone at Microsoft for all of the work. And we're really excited. So thank you.
All right. Ashley Arnold from Dolby Labs. Great to see you. Say hello to everybody down there at Dolby, and we'll get you on again in the future.
As promised, here he is sitting with me. I'm in his private studio, Mr. Panos Panay, the legendary Panos. It's good to see you, man.
You too. It's amazing to see you. So, should I call you Larry or Major Nelson? As we hang out, it's Larry, but as we're here, what do you want?
The gamers call me Larry. They call me Major Nelson. I'll answer to anything. That's the way it works with my family as well.
Well, to my son, you're Major Nelson. I want to be super clear.
First of all, I got to tell you, thank you. I'm so excited to talk to you. You and I have worked, you know, kind of around each other for many years.
Yeah.
You've been working on Surface. You're now in charge of Windows. Like
I don't know if I'm in charge. I'm definitely part of it, that's for sure.
But that's really amazing to see all the, kind of your what we call in corporate speak, span of control, right? Remember
sure,
that term?
Sure, I do.
But it's interesting to see the things you do. But I want to talk a little bit about, we've got some new products to talk about. Windows is coming out next week, depending upon when you're listening to this.
Yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit about your journey?
So here's what's interesting. When I came to the company, you might find some of this interesting. Maybe not.
Yeah.
When I came to the company, I came as to work on hardware.
Yep.
And hardware at that time, we were just starting Xbox.
Yep.
And you know that sophistication around what it means from an end-to-end device standpoint. But we shipped millions of mice and keyboards a year.
People forget that the IntelliMouse and the IntelliKeyboard and all of that. There's every people love these devices.
Right, and that was kind of exciting. But I remember telling my dad. I remember when I was going to join Microsoft, and there was a whole series of events that got me here. Which it's a whole thing. I was born at anyway, and get me in trouble. But there was this opportunity back then. You can see it like the Microsoft was a software company for sure, back then, 20 years ago or so. they were doing hardware in bits and bobs, and ultimately it was this, it was the beginning of completing the experience. And then Xbox showed up, and mouse was basically making Word and better, and then the World Wide Web, at the, if you will, Internet Explorer, and that the input devices mattered. And I had this opportunity to come and be part of that team. Here's what's interesting for you. You might find this interesting.
Yeah.
One of my favorite brands before I got here was a brand called Sidewinder. It was the gaming brand for Microsoft at the time.
That's right.
And they did mice and keyboards and headsets, and they did some
flight sticks and joysticks.
Yeah, flight sticks are rad.
Yeah.
Like some super cool stuff. And so one of the things I got to do while I was here after the first or second year doing mice and keyboards, we brought gaming back for peripherals, because when I got here, Sidewinder wasn't shipping. And then we brought it back, and we partnered with a friend of mine, Min, over at Razer, and we had built a mouse together called Habu.
Yep.
And we had this, I mean, this, you know, part of my love for what gaming meant to me back then, especially, was these peripherals. And so there's a little history. It ties off to you in some weird indirect way.
Yeah, because you've always been in the Xbox. People may not, they certainly know you now because you've done some amazing work on Surface and with Windows 11, which we'll talk about in a minute. But you've kind of been on the periphery of gaming for quite some time in terms of your impact has been felt on us in terms of, especially with Xbox Series X and S. I know that, you know, your hardware team worked with us on that. So that's been amazing. Obviously, the controller is, you know, you talked about the Sidewinder, and this is a direct descendant of all that
work.
It
kind of is. And you know, we have some amazing leaders across organizations, of course, in hardware and software and Xbox. And we have labs for human factors where this controller, and I've watched it evolve over the years, and I certainly won't claim I did anything for it or to it. I have this, I've either been part of or have led amazing teams. And now I just, that have built these products over the years, and I can't tell you, like, you would be, I mean, you've seen it all.
Yeah.
But you go into the human factors lab, you could just look at the ergonomics of everything, what it means to game for everyone, what it means to build products so everyone can game, if you will. There's inspiration. There's so many stories of inspiration in there that start from a hardware standpoint. But in my career, I started with mouse and keyboards. And at some point, there was a moment where we needed to complete the experience for Windows. And that's where Surface was kind of born. Or maybe I shouldn't say that's where Surface was created, I think.
Yeah.
It wasn't called Surface when we started. There's a good story there. But basically, we
needed... Because I remember the Surface devices. They were much larger.
Yeah, right. So I actually ran that group too. It was like Surface Table.
Right.
Awesome. Like, it was the first touch, basically the first touch device out there with this interaction model. And you can sit around the table, and some magical experiences for sure. And then, you know, as it evolved, we had this need for... basically to, you know, for tablets, PCs, what did it mean to complete the whole Windows experience? And that kind of just snowballed into a pretty incredible set of products.
Yeah. And we'll talk about those a little bit later. I want to talk about Windows, though. Windows 11, starting to shipping next week to a lot of folks.
I'm pretty pumped about it.
It's kind of a staggered roll, but we've got it here on one of the new devices we'll talk about. I've been using it for quite a few months. It's interesting because it's different but familiar.
Yeah.
Tell me about your involvement in that design and how you let's move the, like, something radical like moving the start menu, the button to the center of the screen. I mean, these are all things that I can imagine. I can just in my head.
I'm still getting feedback, by the way.
I'm thinking of the hours of meetings you had over that.
Yeah, I think a ton. Like, but at the end of the day, you're right. You use the right set of words in familiar. One of the principles behind the product and of design was you need it to be modern, feel modern. It was meant to be calm. It was meant to draw you in, and it's meant to essentially get out of your way. And then you can do the things you want to do, including game.
Yeah.
And if you do that elegantly, it's almost impossible to define it. It's something you feel.
Right.
And one way to make that true was keep that familiarity, but make enough subtle and then some major changes that are, you know, whether it's rounded corners, use of materials, colors, and positioning of an icon, the way the product windows, just and then under the covers, you know, like think about what we did with some of the features specific for gaming, if you will. You can draw from all that, but at the end of the day, it was meant to feel like home.
Right.
That was an important element. I talked about this at launch. Some people kind of grasp it, but others, I think, look at me funny. But it is that idea that, you know, those things that you're familiar with, modernized. And so let's say taking you back to your childhood, what are the things that you love so much? They've probably evolved by now, but they still feel familiar. It's still innate to you. You still understand how to either turn the doorknob, or you know where the light switch was in your home, or you know what table you loved at the restaurant you used to go to. The table's probably there, but it's probably a new table. The light switch is probably still there, but you know, maybe the walls have been painted.
Yeah.
And it is those, the essence of those changes around you, that evolution of technology that's so important to all of us to help us move forward, to help us get things done that we want to get done, to help us get to our most creative self, to be the best gamer that we can be. All of that is part of this tech coming together, and at the same time, the tech getting out of your way. And so the design ethos around Windows 11 was somewhere in that area. It's a lot simpler than that. And you know, like anything, it starts unbelievably primitive, and then it gets unbelievably complex, and then we end up in a simple space. And I think what you're seeing with Windows 11 is quite a bit of like complexity reduced to its simplest form, and now it's powerful.
Yeah,
it's powerful for people to use and create off of.
And more importantly, you know, for this audience, gaming. I mean, that's
huge. Huge.
Yeah, I mean, I know that people often forget, and I will tell people this is like,
yeah,
hey, Windows is Microsoft's other gaming platform because millions of people are gaming on Windows every single day.
Are you kidding? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it is. It's arguably the largest gaming platform out there.
I think you can say that.
Yeah.
Almost definitively.
Yeah. So I mean, yeah. So now you're kind of rolling into the gaming space. Tell me about working with Phil and our team on the Xbox team and what it means to bring that Xbox gaming experience or part of it.
Phil, start Windows. With Phil.
Yeah.
First off, he's both a mentor to me and an incredible inspiration at the same time. And sometimes those conflict,
yeah,
you know, because you can get a little bit. But boy, he's helped me through not only my career in thinking about, you know, how to make hard decisions and do the right things for people and organizations, but he's also inspired me on how to make products, how to think about doing the best you can do for your customer. Like, he's an extraordinary person. Extraordinary human being, extraordinary leader, and
yeah,
he probably won't want to hear that. So if you want to just cut that out, no, that's fine. I he's so humble,
yeah,
and so that'll be he'd probably be like, "What are you doing?" And I'm sorry, Phil. Hopefully he cuts it, but if he doesn't, I'm sorry.
I'm not going to. It's all true.
Yeah. You know, maybe you should. But the idea that we were building a, you know, that we can build a product for gamers with Windows 11, that was so important. It was one of the anchoring tenets of, you know, when you think about it, we talk about something familiar. You build something. And it remind, you know, it feels familiar, feels calm, and all the beauty and the aesthetic and so forth, that was important. But then you have just anchoring tenets on the product. I won't get into all of them, but one,
sure,
of them was gaming.
Yeah.
Straight up. We know Windows needs to be great for gamers, period. And so just the features of direct storage, which basically gets your game faster, period. It's very quite simple. It's, mm-hmm, that's what we needed. That's what we wanted. The Xbox team fills vision, I mean, did incredible work, and they bring it to life. You think about DirectX 12 Ultimate and what it means to gamers. You can push boundaries with auto HDR. So, you know, the refresh rates where you get the light and the ultimate pieces for gaming and feeling like you're part of that game. And, you know, I'm a novice gamer at best. I don't know what that means. I'm a terrible gamer, my son will tell you, whatever. I thought I was good at one point, but
that's okay. You, yeah, game, that's the most important
thing.
Yeah,
but not so much. And then I think the ultimate piece was I'm not sure what the right words are, but that blend of hardware and software. Think of Xbox Game Pass coming, yeah, to life on the product. And then when you start taking and you start stacking up, whether it's Game Pass, DirectX, direct storage or HDR, like you're in this zone of, wow, we've got the best Windows ever for gamers.
Yeah.
And then you got OEMs who are building devices and who are pumped about it.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's
so OEMs, for those who don't, original equipment manufacturers.
Well done. Done. Like, I'm lost in myself.
That's okay.
You got Lenovo's Legion.
Yeah.
You have Dell, Alienware. I won't tell you, I love them all, and I try and use them all.
So right,
even ask me which one
you
use. Don't do that.
There's something for everybody.
HP is incredible in their gaming line. Acer, ASUS.
You mentioned Min Lee and Razer.
Yep. Yeah, and Min does incredible work with his PCs and peripherals. And he's making this cool COVID mask right now. I saw that too.
Yeah. I don't know what he's doing over there.
Yeah, yeah, it's very funny. Yeah, but yeah, there's some pretty cool stuff.
But yeah, I mean, it's amazing that, you know, we talk about Windows as this amazing platform, but now, it's been Xbox and Windows is over here, and over the past few years, we've brought on Game Bar and things like that. But now that Game Pass is there, and you can stream your console games, and even from the cloud, stream them onto
your... So both, important, right?
Yeah.
You can, so for the gamers that are Xbox gamers and you want to stream from your console, my son does this.
Yeah.
When he comes home, when I try and get him home on the weekends when I can, that's how I see him gaming on his Surface from an Xbox.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. Or you can stream direct from the cloud. Like, they're both awesome. I mean, the tech is mind blowing and the gameplay is perfect.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's just going to get even better.
Yeah, it's just going to keep getting better. I mean, the team is so focused on it and just, yeah, it's pretty awesome.
I mean, that's the beautiful part about, like, we talk about game streaming this week, you know, we released out to insiders, the ability that you're gonna be able to stream games to your console from the cloud while it's loading in the background. And you can stream games to your PC without ever installing them. I mean, there's just games. Phil, you know, I know folks have heard me say this, and I know you've heard Phil say this, is that when everybody plays, we all win.
Yeah.
And that means
inspiring, right? When you hear that?
It's such a fascinating statement, because it's like, what everybody plays, meaning whether you're on an Android device, an iOS device, an iPad, whatever you're on, or when you look at our adaptive controller work with accessibility. I mean, that, right?
Yeah, that one's near and dear to my heart.
And you guys did some great work with a couple weeks ago, and you announced the Surface Adaptive Kit.
Yeah.
Which is kind of, it's tell me a little bit about this, because this is really interesting.
Yeah, it's very similar. Like, you want to, very similar to the sense of, you know, when everyone games, we all win. When everyone can be productive, a very similar kind of ethos. At the end of the day, you want to design products for everyone. You think about designing a product for over a billion people,
that's the closest thing to one size fits all that there is, right?
Yeah, it's like, I love that. My favorite, who's your customer for Windows? I'm like, oh, well, I mean, there's over one.
Here's the globe.
but one of the things is making products, you know, accessible to everybody.
Yeah.
And that's in my, it's in my team's bones. You know, we have this cultural element. We talked about being human.
Yeah.
And being human is not only how we treat each other, not only how we care for each other, but it's also how we build products for people, what inclusive design means. And the adaptive kit is just one example of many. I think there's nuance in every product when we think about, how do we make these products more accessible? How does everybody get a chance to use them? How do we make sure we're taking the right feedback for those?
Right.
And very clear, you know, there's nothing better than the feedback of, this doesn't work for me, this does work for me, and so forth.
But there's also no better feedback than when you see someone with that adaptive controller who has never been able to game before.
Are you kidding me? There's no greater joy as a product maker to see somebody use your product and whether
that could never
it was
use it
the
before.
Adaptive controller. Come on. It's so special.
Yeah.
And not like, yeah, it's just real.
Yeah.
It's so real. And, you know, with the adaptive kit, it was one of the simplest things we talk about. You know, sometimes the smallest things have the biggest impact. Here, we're talking about a sticker. We're talking about, you know, a lever, if you will, or a hook. Just something where it makes it easier for, you know, lower dexterity to be able to open a kickstand or even the lid of your laptop. And it works for everybody.
Yeah.
And now you start making a true difference for people's lives. And if you want to make a difference, like for me, one of the main purposes is, how do I make a difference? What are the differences I get to make in this world? What are the things that I can impact? With the adaptive kit, I'm quite sensitive about it, you know, and I'm very proud of the team and what they've done and how they've accomplished the design ethos around it. And for those that saw the launch video, we have some pretty incredible leaders as well that just drive to the depth of what the product can be. Yeah. And now you have something that,
you know, I mean, everybody can get one of these.
How do we get it to as many people as we can that need it?
Yeah.
And that's where we're at now.
We talked a little bit, you know, we started with a Surface Adaptive Kit, but you had a whole amazing range of devices you announced a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
I'm using one of them right here with this with the Surface Laptop.
Yeah, you got the Laptop Studio.
With the pen, and I'm all ready to go here. But it's an amazing device, but there's a whole bunch of different devices. You can see there's a lot of really cool stuff your team is working on, including, you know,
You got a duo.
The duo, yeah, you know, the duo too, which with this amazing camera and NFC and everything.
That's a rad product.
Yeah.
So like there's a lot going on. We have the Pro 8, we have the Laptop Studio, we have the Duo 2, we have the Go 3.
Yep.
And you know, the idea that there's a product for everyone,
yep,
the same idea. Our OEMs have this range of devices that's incredible. They're all tied to Windows 11. So the launch of Windows 11 is October 5th. The launch of the Surface devices, October 5th. Yep. A ton of new OEM devices coming, some already announced, some to be announced.
Yep.
That's both gaming and non-gaming,
sure,
if you will.
Yep.
The Surface Laptop Studio, just speaking to gamers, like it's an incredible gaming device. Like,
I've been playing Deathloop on this.
I get in trouble because it's not defined as a
gaming device. I know, it's not a gaming device, but I've been playing Deathloop on it, and I'm having a great time. I bind my controller up, and away I go.
Yeah, I play Fortnite on it. I have to tell you, it is, the screen is incredible, and when you get to the Auto HDR, you start to feel Windows 11 come to life.
Yep.
Like, it's pretty rad.
Yeah.
It's pretty rad.
The one thing, you know, you and I have talked frequently over the years, but I always talk to your team members about, you always seem to, your passion around hinges is unmatched. So I love the fact that you've really, in at least with the Surface Studio and with Surface and Duo, you're always doing something interesting in the physicality of the space.
So there is a blend of hardware and software that's needed, and there is something about products that can adapt to you, and it just so happens if the product adapts to you, you'll be more productive, you'll find your flow, you can be more creative.
Right.
Because you don't want to have to think about what position you want the device in, if you're going to use your pen, your keyboard, your mouse, you're going to speak, you're going to touch the screen. You shouldn't have to think about it. You should just be able to flow through your day and what you're trying to do. Part of that is a little bit of the physicality. It's the hinge, of course. Like there's a lot of memes out there like, oh my God, they love their hinges, don't they? Like, we got, I believe, maybe the best mechanical engineers on the planet that work in Surface and Xbox. And getting a hinge right from a friction, feel, sound.
Durability.
Reliability.
Yeah, reliability.
Oh my goodness, are you kidding? Like they're every little detail there, and we have a history.
Yeah.
I think the first Surface we launched was... had a kickstand, the Surface RT, and it was really, it only had one stop it had one click stop on the kickstand. And what we had learned so quickly was this thing has to adapt further to different positions, different people, what they needed. And it came down to the perfection of a hinge to bring that to life.
Yeah.
And now you'll see hinges in products all over the planet. You'll see them on all kinds of two-in-ones. You'll see them on different keyboards, different setups and so forth. A lot of that inspired, I think, by the original Surface thinking.
Well, I know you and I can go on for an hour about a hinge, and we don't want to talk about
that. Yeah, you want to get into the hinges.
And I need to let you get going in a little bit. But, I want to find, you know, we talked about Windows, you know, launching next week, Windows 11, which is an upgrade for some folks, and the great new devices both your team and all of our OEMs have done. We need to get you on Xbox, though. So we want to know, what are you playing now? Let's talk about that.
Yeah, let's talk about So I've said this before.
Yep.
I actually posted my first victory royale on Fortnite. I was so proud.
Well done.
My daughter quickly told me it's because you're not good.
Okay, well,
so you play
try hard.
Gaming's been pretty special to me in that sense. So, you know, my connection to two of my daughters is through Fortnite in many ways. Like we sit down, we play it together. Like, do you want to play, Dad? Do you want to play? That kind of bled into Among Us. And so like they got me into Among Us. So on my PC, we do a lot of, I feel like I'm pretty good at Among Us, but I can't go too far into that. Yeah. And then I play Call of Duty. That's more for myself at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Because one, I get so frustrated building in Fortnite.
Right.
Because by the time I've gotten two structures, there's somebody who's got 30 and I'm,
right.
And
I'm, they're taking you down.
I don't know what happened. And, but Call of Duty is that one. And I think you find this, I don't know if this is accurate cause I don't study it, but it's like this huge tension relief.
Sure.
And it's because there's so much stress when I'm playing.
Right.
Is that weird?
Yeah. No, that's
like, I get so stressed.
Have you ever rage quit?
Oh, should I admit that? Let me think about it.
Maybe not.
Yes, I have actually.
Okay.
I have. But like when I get sniped and I don't know even where it came from.
Right. Classic Call of Duty.
I don't, I just, And okay. That's all I want to do.
Right.
But I can't. I'm not, my trigger's not
quick. We need enough. To get you, and I know we need to let you go, but we're doing this weekend, depending on when you're listening or watching this, we're doing a Halo multiplayer this weekend for the beta. We need to get you in on that.
I would love to. I was going to go out of town this weekend, but I don't think I am now.
Well.
So I might be able to sit down and do it. And by the way.
Yeah.
My son called me the other day, and he said he was on the Halo Infinite beta.
Yeah, we did one last weekend with. And you're not playing it?
No. I'm like, what are you talking about? Yeah. Like, what would he told me? I'm like, what are you talking about?
Send a note off to Phil.
Yeah, like, why? How come I'm not on the Halo Infinite beta? That was driving me nuts.
Well, you're a little busy building, making sure Windows is shipping and getting these products out the door, so you're a little bit busy.
You know what I do love playing, by the way? Yeah. Here's another one for you. I love playing Madden Mobile.
Yeah.
So I'm an NFL fan. You know, Surface is part of the NFL.
Yeah, right.
I mean, I love it. Yeah. I always wonder, like, I probably spend too much money buying packs on that thing.
Right.
It's pretty awesome.
That's the loop.
Yeah, I get stuck. I'm like addicted. I played on my Surface Duo. It's pretty dang cool. Like,
it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Talk about Surface Duo. We need to let you go. I love, if you get a chance, and I posted this on my Twitter, just doing the touch controls that we're bringing with cloud.
So this is another kind of Xbox Vision piece, like pretty amazing work from the Xbox team. You know, top screen has the game, bottom screen is a controller. It's like a classic form factor from when I was a kid.
Right.
I mean,
right.
And
the dual screens.
Yep. And then you have Game Pass. It comes to life. Like, it's super awesome. Yeah. Like, it is. It's one of those disappearing into it. And, you know, my daughter's asking me for a Surface Duo, and I haven't. You know, it's just about to launch.
Come on, Dad.
I know. It's her birthday. I'm like, gosh, do I really get a streak? Am I really going to do that? But I think there's a pretty good amount of energy around that product right now, and especially for gamers. If you haven't seen it, check it out. It's pretty amazing. I don't know if you can put B-roll on this or not, but it's a pretty cool experience.
I'll put some stuff on my Twitter. Anyway, Panos, okay. I need to let you go. I know they're getting you out of here. Really appreciate you coming on the podcast.
Thanks.
Can we get you on again?
You can get me anytime. I would love to just come talk to you. I mean, I don't know if this is entertaining for anyone or if they think it's interesting, but
it is for me.
You, being here with you is like a dream, and talking about Xbox, one of my favorite products on the planet. And then
you're so kind.
And talking about, you know, being able to reflect the team and hopefully some of their values is pretty inspiring.
Congratulations on the launch of Windows and all the great Surface devices. Panos, thanks again.
You bet.
Thank you to Panos, Katie, and Ashley for joining us this week. A lot of great interviews and good news, but that's not all the news that we have. So first up, we have September 30th.
Nice segue.
September 30th, which, thank you. I know, I've been working on it. So this week released Marvel's Avengers is coming to Xbox Game Pass for PC, console, and cloud. That includes the newest expansion, which is Black Panther War for Wakanda. So that includes the full game and all of the heroes and missions that have launched after release. Again, that's out on Xbox Game Pass now. We also have a bunch of new games with gold for October. So we have Arrow, Huffer, and then on back compat, we have Castlevania, Harmony of Despair, Resident Evil Code Veronica X. And as a reminder, like, games with gold are available for anyone that's on Xbox Live Gold or Xbox Game Pass Ultimate members.
Yes.
I think that for Xbox Game Pass, there's actually...
You never did?
Yeah. No, we need to do that. You know,
well, now's an opportunity.
It's a good one. It's a classic. I know. No excuse now.
We got a lot of news this week. I know. What else do you have anything over there? I know Jeff's been. Let me put it to you this way, folks. For those of you tuning in, you know Jeff normally does the news. There's so much news this week. We had to split it. We kind of had to one this way and one that way. So
couldn't carry the load on my own.
Yeah, I didn't want you to buckle. So what do you got, Jeff?
Oh, just sort of. I just wanted to talk about a couple tabs on loose ends. So a few months ago, we had some folks from Lemnisgate, which is sort of a shooter game where, actually not completely unlike Deathloop, where you sort of you replay something multiple times and you build on your previous things. It looks a lot like All-Star Brawl, apparently.
That's
Larry.
Coming up later. I'm excited. I just wanted to punch that in there because I'm so excited about it.
So excited. And we can get to that as soon as we can. But anyway, Lemnisgate seems really interesting. Great game for Game Pass because it's one of those games that's a little bit tough to explain. And so you can just try it out and you know, figure it out for yourself. Is it for you? Maybe it is. This is another very exciting. This was sort of a late-breaking tweet that we saw this week. Disco Elysium, which PC Games, I think it was either PC Games N or PC Gamer, recently put it like the top of their 100 games of all time. Well, It was not out on Xbox. It is coming out on Xbox and very soon. Digital version October 12th, physical edition November 9th. Very excited about that one. I'm sure we'll be talking more about it because, I mean, I'll be playing it. Rebecca, you talked about a Castlevania game, Harmony. Was it Harmony of Dissonance? Was that the one?
Harmony of Despair.
With gold. Harmony of Despair. So there's another one with Dissonance, I swear. So anyway, there's four new like classic Castlevania games, like from the DS and the Game Boy Advance. And there were some really good ones back in the day. And it's called the Castlevania Advance Collection. It has Circle of the Moon, Harmony of Dissonance, I knew there was Dissonance somewhere, Aria of Sorrow, and Dracula X, which was from like the Japanese TurboGrafx-16. Anyway, kind of cool, like piece of history there. And those are also out. So maybe if you like what you really play with Harmony of Despair, you can see where that one came from.
We were talking about, we are, you know, we're now, it's October, folks. It's now October when you listen to this and beyond. So we are what we like to say in the industry. We're in the shoot. There are a lot of games happening, and it's just going to be bang, 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 bang. Right, Jeff? Right, Rebecca?
Yeah. And speaking of, this is the time of year where you get to play FIFA. So the new FIFA 22, the Ultimate Edition came available a little bit early. By the time you hear this one, I believe the more regular retail version will be out as well. So tons of stuff there. I've got it. I need to play it. It's got Kylian Mbappe on the front. So, you know. He's sort of the new Messi, at least when it comes to FIFA covers. So tell me if you remember this. We've all gone to Gamescom recently, and usually we end up flying.
Well, not recently, but
not recently, 2 years ago. But it's sad. I'm sad now. Flying in and out of Dusseldorf, I recall there's always been a lounge in there called the Hugo Junkers Lounge. Definitely. And I was just like, do you remember that?
You and I spent a lot of time in the Junkers Lounge.
And I was like, well, what is this name? Who's Hugo Junkers? I know now.
Yes.
Because Microsoft Flight Simulator has released its first aircraft in the Local Legends series. And so the Junkers JU-52 airplane.
Junkers, Jeffrey.
No, we're not in Junkers. Rebecca's Junkers. In New York City. J-U-N-K-E-R-S. I took French, so you know, I don't know. It's Junkers. Anyway, okay, Hunkers? Is that what you're saying?
Junkers.
Now you're adding Y's. You don't even
I know now it's changing. Yeah.
Well, anyway, so it's a famous German plane from the 1930s, and the new World Update 6 was focused on Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. And to complement that, why not fly over it in a classic Junkers. German plane, which is now available. Just check news.xbox.com. We've got all your flight sim.
Go back a couple weeks when I had Jorgon from the flight sim team. He actually talks all about this. And Jeff, I don't know if we talked about this on the air during the interview, but Jorg told me that that plane for a long time, the original plane was at that airport. Like it was
at Dusseldorf.
Yeah, it was stored somewhere else. So that has that particular airport had some significance to the Junkers, and it's not there anymore, but it used to be a long time ago. So that's the end of the story.
Wait, now you're saying Junkers
and Junkers.
Junkers? You're just messing with me. You're just messing with me.
Yes.
So Flight Sim, right, good stuff there. Lots of good stuff coming with Flight Sim.
Lots of games coming out now. Big games, small games. One I did want to call out, Hot Wheels Unleashed. So I always really love the Hot Wheels expansion for Forza Horizon.
Yeah.
Was it four?
Four.
Three. It was three, I think, because four was Legos, which was also just amazing. But there's a Hot Wheels Unleashed game, and it's really cool because you're racing these small, you know, matchbox-sized cars, but in like they're in rooms. It's like tracks are set up, so you're not just outside. It's like you're racing through a mansion where like these cool tracks have been set up.
And those infamous yellow tracks really that used to click together when you were a little kid. Remember those?
And the cars would go flying off because you would
not on the track. Yeah,
you didn't understand physics and you didn't care.
I didn't care, but it does look like they're doing all kinds of. There's like a Back to the Future.
It's a DeLorean.
It doesn't say that specifically, so I don't know. There's a Charlie Brown car. I'm trying not to you do any copyright infringement here, Larry,
I don't know. Charlie Brown doesn't even drive a car.
I know. I don't remember any cars.
I'm looking at a picture here, Larry, and it is literally like, well, it's more like Snoopy. If Snoopy's like that red doghouse that he would sleep in the cartoons, yeah. If that was like mounted on four wheels with an external engine,
well, he's called that the Sopwith Camel. That's kind of cool. That's what he, and he would fight the Red Baron.
That was a plane. So imagine
over Dusseldorf.
You're bringing it. You know what, Larry? It just looks really cool, and I just wanted to.
I'm
call
sure
that
it does.
Out.
I don't have a picture of that, or I'd show you. I'm sorry.
Anyways, and then lastly, wait, do we have a reveal? Are we breaking news here?
I have to tell you something. We get approached by everybody across the gaming industry to be on the show, and we have to say no a lot of times, and we have to say yes a lot of times.
That's not true.
That's very true. But yes, we do have a reveal. In fact, Rebecca is going to share with us details of this reveal right now. Rebecca, what do you got?
Yeah, so Nickelodeon All-Stars Brawl is going to be launching next week on October 5th.
Here
and
it is.
Two new characters that have been revealed are Aang and... I'm like waiting for it. Are you going to roll?
Larry, hit the button.
Well, it's funny. I've got...
Button, Larry.
Our new characters are Cartoon Violence and Comic Mischief.
I've got
video here of both of them and not one of them together. So Aang and Korra, as Rebecca said, are coming to Nickelodeon All-Stars Brawl. Both of them are available Xbox Series X and S and Xbox One on October 5th. Let's play this one now so you can kind of see them.
You just have to wonder, like, what kind of luck would, I don't know, like, Doug or, like, you know, SpongeBob have against Aang or Korra, who are like martial artists with special abilities.
Well, this is great.
I feel curious. Like I take them in a fight.
I'm curious what. What you waiting for? So I thought,
there you go. There's Aang.
Okay. I'm like waiting to see if he's doing anything besides airbending. It doesn't look like it. Whereas Korra, it's interesting. Korra, I definitely saw. Oh, wait. There we go.
Because did he master all of the different elements?
I mean, yeah, to be the Avatar, you have to master all the elements, but he does mostly just use airbending, whereas it looks like Korra is using all of them.
This is ridiculously small, but those are all the moves.
Yeah. So. Okay, so it is just airbending, yeah.
Yeah, so like airbending, okay, and then here are Korra's moves.
Yeah, you're right. Korra's using flame and... Yeah, water. You're right.
Anyway,
I was looking at the lineup. It's pretty interesting.
Have you looked at the whole lineup? Because there's a lot of your favorites are in there. A lot of the Nickelodeon.
There's some obscure stuff in here, like Powdered Toast Man from Ren and Stimpy, which was
that's a deep cut.
Yeah,
that's a very deep cut. And I always thought it was funny because every time he bent over, he would fart. And so I wonder if they put that in the game.
That'd be a great move.
It was Ren and Stimpy. It is the grossest cartoon ever made. That was the least of it.
Right.
So, anyway, I want to play this game.
I think it's important to point out, Rebecca, do you have the details? If you pre-order it, what happens?
Thank you, Larry. If you pre-order now, then you get 20% off the game. So
Nickelodeon All-Stars.
Check it out.
There you go. Nickelodeon All-Stars Brawl coming with those great Aang from Last Avatar and Korra from Legend of Korra announced right here on this. We only get the best. The bestest. We only get the bestest.
I mean, those are probably
the
top two characters. So there you go.
Honestly.
Farting powder.
Yeah.
All right. We got a lot going on, don't we, gang? I know you're busy. Rebecca, how are things over? You know, you work on the Minecraft business. How are things on Minecraft?
It's really busy right now. I mean, Minecraft is kind of perpetually busy, but we actually have Minecraft Live coming up in a few weeks. So October 16th, it's going to be our annual broadcast. It's where we announce, like, you know, the next update to the game. We're going to be doing like another mob vote. We have a lot of different like YouTubers and streamers who are going to be joining too. It's pretty cool. It's October 16th. I'm definitely going to be plugging it for the next two episodes.
That's why I wanted you to say.
Yeah. I know. Thank you, Larry.
Are you going to be in it?
Are you going to be in it?
Not this year. I know. I had very small background roles. I was the annoyed studio stage manager for 1 year, being like, where's this person in like the intro video, but no, I'm not gonna be there.
Is that the year that they had the llama in there?
Yes, that was. And Will Arnett.
That's right.
It was an interesting show. I like where we've landed now instead with like YouTubers and stuff in it. It seems a little bit more natural.
Well, we'll look for, and as Rebecca said, you'll be hearing more about that on future shows. And then when we get closer, we'll remind you how, when, and where to tune in to watch that, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, good. Good stuff. All right. Jeff, you have something like you
I'm finding
like
one other thing, and I didn't know if you wanted to talk about it. Found it in the notes, and that is about the Xbox Cloud Gaming Beta.
Oh, yeah.
Which, if you're, depending on what level of insider you are, if you're like one of those deep, like alpha level insiders, you might have access to this now. This is something that I saw it on the Insider blog. We've talked about it, but ultimately, there's a section like within the Game Pass section of your Xbox. You go in the dashboard and you'll see games and it's like, stream them right now. Yeah. And you might think, well, why would I do that? But it's really cool to be able to see, you know, let me just try this game, see if I'm into it before I commit to a
download.
I don't know, 30 gig download or something like that. And then
let me see what it's like before I commit to pressing A, right?
Try before you buy. Exactly.
Yeah. That's actually true, Jeff, and that'll be rolling out, you know, as we get closer in the coming weeks/months to everybody else. But it's on Insider, so sign up for Insiders if you want to do this. Really kind of cool because you go through and you can even see it in the store, and it's like, hey, do you want to stream this right now? Click A and
yeah, it just says instead of it'll say install, like right, which it normally says now if you're right, looking in the Game Pass section. But next to it, it'll say play, and then you just hit it, and then you see if you've used cloud gaming on, you know, on your phone or a browser, PC, whatever it might be. You see that rocket ship going.
I don't know where that rocket there came from. That rocket doesn't mean anything. If I looked at that, I'm like, why is there a rocket here? Why is
because the game is rocketing through the internet to.
Why isn't it like a little controller dancing across your screen or something? I don't know.
Does your controller dance?
My rocket doesn't. Wait, what controller is that?
Oh, you're just showing off that you have that controller. Oh,
Master Chief, but yeah.
No, let me just flex. Let me just grab the nearest controller to me. Oh, this one? This old thing?
That's the one I use. Don't tell me you wouldn't use it.
If I had it, I'd use it too.
Exactly. All right, gang. Got a bunch of big few weeks coming up. We got Far Cry coming out in the future. We've got what else do you have a list? Can you pull that up? Either one of you pull up a list of what we got coming out in October? I don't know if it's
at the end of the month we've got Age of Empires 4, which will be coming out on the 28th, 9th, 7th, last towards the very end there. So very excited about that. I remember Battlefield did push out a little bit. That's a really good question. What else we've got?
I'm not going to put you on the spot, Jeff or Rebecca. I'll come back and we can.
You already did. You can't put someone on the spot and go.
I know. I can with editing. I could remove it. So, but
Jeff was rising to the challenge.
You won't.
No.
All right. I've got it.
All right.
Our good friends at USA Today, Metroid Dread. Looking forward to that one. Heard good things. Back for Blood. That was the other one. So that's October 12th coming to Xbox Game Pass. We have Far Cry on the 7th. We'll probably be able to talk about that next show, next time we're here.
Yep.
And then Back for Blood. I really want to play with you guys. I got to play it with some folks from Destructoid and someone else on my team during a media preview. And then there was the beta and I ended up playing through it again. So I really had a lot of fun with it. And it's pure co-op. Let's do it.
Pure co-op. Let's do it. We're going to do it. But this weekend, do you have anything else you want to add, Rebecca, before we wrap up here?
No, just this weekend's going to be Big Team Battle.
Yep, Halo Infinite. Battle. So we're going to get you into Big Team Battle, right? We'll get Jeff into it. Well, me, all three of us. Did you see, you weren't on this email, Rebecca, but I'll share a little bit of inside baseball. Did you see, I sent it to Jeff. I'm arranging a play date on Friday night, which is when the show airs tonight. Trying to get Jeff on. I'm trying to get Phil to play Big Team. Phil Spencer to play Big Team Battle with us. So I think he's in, Jeff.
That'd be great. Although I'm still a little bit like when Rainbow Six Siege first came out and we ran with Phil, and that's a very tense game. And very we were tense. Sort of waiting. I think we were on defense and we were waiting for the other team to come and invade. And I was so nervous and I ended up pulling the trigger and shooting Phil in the back. I didn't kill him.
Wow.
But he noticed.
Xbox boss Phil, huh?
Shoot me in the back, and I couldn't find my voice at that point. And he knows.
Jeff has quit the game. So
yeah,
Jeff has left the chat.
So it's funny, during the interview that I did with Panos that we aired earlier today or earlier in the show, I was talking with him before, or maybe it was after, and I was telling him about the big team. I was like, oh, invite me. I want to play with Phil. So I got Panos at once. So I think we're going to be rolling with a pretty big squad, hopefully, on over the weekend. Stay tuned.
Real quickly, because you did call us into it, and NHL will be coming out in age. Alan Wake Remastered. And I don't recall, did we talk about that last week?
We talked a little bit about it. I'm trying to line up an interview with Sam Lake, so stay tuned for that.
Oh, that'd be great, because it's just an awesome game. Obviously, it's available, it via backward compatibility, so you may have already played it on Xbox. I actually played it last summer. Had I known, I would have rated it with a remaster, but it's, I will say the action and the horror and everything definitely holds up. And with it being remastered, it will, not look like a game from 2007, eight. I can't remember what it was. Yeah.
A while ago. Let's just say a decade ago.
At least.
We've got a lot of interviews. I know each one of you we're on a separate email thread about that. So we've got some really good interviews as always lined up for the future, because we'd like to do some good stuff there and get some talk to some developers about their games so you guys can learn more about them. All right, we're going to wrap
Larry,
it up.
Let's say you get out of here and we roll on down to Midtown. We just skate on through. You can visit Rebecca. If you hear wheels coming, two sets of wheels, it's because we figured out how to put wheels on this thing. And we also learned how to skate. We came to visit. Just a few steps, a few small steps need to happen.
All right, just wear helmets, guys. All right, you're not kids anymore.
Full body helmet.
Sorry.
Yeah, I'm gonna go in the Michelin Man outfit. All right. We'll see you guys on everybody. Hopefully, we'll see you on Big Team Battle this weekend. We had a lot of fun with y'all last weekend, and look forward to running into you on the battlefield. Jeff and Rebecca, unless you guys have anything else, you want to do like and subscribe? We kind of did that at the top of the show, Jeff.
We did. So we don't need to do it now.
They know how to find us.
I'm done.
So don't like and subscribe. Yeah.
No, don't say that. No.
Did I do it, guys?
Okay, that's and if you're looking for us on social, then this is how you find us on social. It's pretty easy to figure it out. So just follow me, follow Jeff, follow Rebecca. Rebecca's got some great tips for living in the city, I guess.
Sure. I guess.
All right.
Thanks, and if you want to check out the latest in Saturday and Sunday morning football action, Jeff's your man. So
yeah. North London is red, and you'll either know what that means or not, and that's fine.
All right, gang, we'll see you guys next week. Have a great weekend in Big Team Battle, and whatever you're playing, I hope you're having fun. Play fair, file feedback, and we'll see you online. Bye-bye, everybody.